Hi. So as mentioned earlier, the accrual basis accounting, it has deferral and accrual basis. So the example on the deferral is, for example, the prepaid rent. We also have the supplies as well as the unearned revenue. Remember, the deferral means that we got the cash in advance, or we paid the cash in advance, and the revenue or the expense has been deferred to the future. So I'm going back to some of the transactions that we recorded in our previous videos for the first two chapters. Those three journals in particular, the prepaid rent and cash and supplies and unearned revenue, there's one more. And what we need to consider here, so let's say they were recorded on January 1st, 2016. Well, what will happen at the end of January or end of February or end of any month after January 1st? What would happen to the balance for the prepaid rent and the supplies and unearned revenue? Is it going to remain the same? I mean, did we pay $1,200 and we considered it an asset for prepaid rent, and it's going to continue being our asset for $1,200 forever? Of course not, because the reason we paid that money is to start consuming it over time. Okay, so let's say that the $1,200 was prepaid for a year, for the 2016 year, starting from January 1st until the end of December 31st for the same year. So if we just make a simple math and consider that the cost for the rent is the same every month, then we just simply divide $1,200 by 12, and that gives us $100 per month. Okay, so in other words, we have to consume $100 every month out of the $1,200 of prepaid rent. Remember, prepaid rent is, it's an asset, and that means it's money that we still own. Now, if I'm gonna consume $100 out of $1,200, that means I'm not gonna own $1,200 anymore for prepaid rent. I'm gonna owe less than that because I'm gonna consume $100. So $100 has to be taken from prepaid rent, and we're gonna transfer it to an expense account. That's exactly what we're gonna do in our adjusting entries. That's an example of an adjustment. So what do we do here? At the end of January 31st, we have to record an adjustment to the prepaid rent. When we consume $100, we have to drop it down by $100, and that's what we say, that's what we call it, an adjustment. Adjusting the ending balance, that's what it means. So prepaid rent has to decrease by $100. So I'm gonna credit prepaid rent, but what about the debit side? Well, the debit side, it's going to be an expense account. What's the best name for that expense account when it comes to prepaid rent? Well, rent expense. So I'm going to debit rent expense. Remember, expenses always increase with a debit. So that expense is increasing. So it's increasing by how much? By $100. An expense account, it's not an asset. It's an income statement account, which we will, which I'm going to show you in chapter 4, in how to prepare the income statement, which will have all the revenues and expenses there. So it's not asset. It's an expense account that goes to income statement. And then in your credit side, you will have the prepaid rent because it's decreasing. And as we know, any asset decreases with a credit. Okay, $100. So after recording that, what is my ending balance for the prepaid rent after decreasing it by $100? Well, if you make a T account, if we have a T account for prepaid rent, we used to have $1,200, and now I'm crediting it by $100. So that will make the ending balance at the end of January 31st only $1,100 for the prepaid rent because I already consumed $100. And then I'm gonna record the exact same journal entry at the end of every month, end of February, March, and so on. So that ending balance will keep decreasing by $100 over time, after every time we record that same journal entry at the end of every month. Okay, and that's exactly what we should do, because that amount is decreasing. What we own from prepaid rent is decreasing over time, because because time passes, that amount of money will be consumed. So that's just one example. So the second example we have, it's the supplies. So we recorded earlier in the previous videos, we debited supplies that we purchased, and we had them on the shelf, and they had a value of $1,000. And the reason why they still have value, because we considered that we still did not use them yet. They were still on the shelf or in the warehouse. But then what happens when we start using those supplies? Are we going to continue having value in them? Well, once you start using them, if those are pens and papers and clips and maybe cleaning supplies, they're not going to have value in them once we start using them. If they are still sealed in the warehouse, then yes, they still have value. But once we start using them, then we have to consume them. We have to record adjusting entry for the amount of supplies that we consumed. Okay, so at the end of January, what we will do is we're gonna go back and find out how much leftover supplies we still have on the shelf or in the warehouse, and what we say in accounting is the leftover supplies, we call them supplies on hand. Okay, so let's say that our supplies on hand at the end of the month were about $700. That means we consumed $300 of supplies, because we started with 1,000. We still have 700 at the end, so we consumed 300, which is 1,000 minus 700. So what happens with that $300 of supplies that we consumed? Well, we're going to transfer it to an expense account. What is the name of that expense account? Supplies expense. Okay, so there's a huge difference between supplies expense and supplies. Supplies expense, it's an expense account. Supplies account is an asset. Okay, supplies expense, that's what we show the amount of supplies we consumed. Supplies, we will show the amount that we still have available, and it still have some value in it, okay? Because it's an asset. That's an expense, the other one is an asset. So debit to an expense account, we're gonna call it supplies expense. And remember, we have to record not the leftover, we have to record what we consumed. Remember, journal entries, we record the changes in the balances for the accounts. So what changes happened to the $1,000 supplies? It decreased by $300. So I'm gonna record $300 in my journal entry, okay? We do not record the ending balances in the journal entries, we record the changes in the balances, okay? Be careful about that. So credit, supplies. $300, because supplies are decreasing, it's an asset, so it goes down with the credit. It's decreasing by 300. Where's that 300 going? It goes to an expense account. Another example, which is the unearned revenue, that's the amount of money that we received in advance, if you still remember. We got $200 in advance for, let's say that it was $2,000 for services that we will provide to a customer in two different sessions. So let's say that the first session will be within January, the second session will be within February. So at the end of January, we already performed a service for $1,000. For example, $1,000 for that customer. So half of the $2,000 has been earned already by the end of January. We still have to provide him a service worth $1,000 next month, which is February. So we still have to keep $1,000 in the unearned revenue. So for now, end of January, we earned $1,000 of, you know, out of the $2,000 unearned revenue. They became a revenue. We're gonna take it from unearned revenue and transfer it to a revenue account. So unearned revenue has to decrease, and then the revenue will increase. So we're not liable as much as we used to be, because now $1,000 out of $2,000 became officially a revenue. So we're less liable now, and then our revenue is increasing. So we're gonna debit the unearned revenue, because it's a liability account and it decreases with a debit. Okay, remember, if a liability goes up with a credit, that means it goes down with the debit. So unearned revenue for $1,000. Remember, we only record the changes. So we're transferring the $1,000 from unearned revenue to a service revenue account, which is an income statement account. So revenue, it's an income statement account. Unearned revenue, it's a balance sheet account. It's under liabilities. Okay, $1,000 of service revenue. Okay, because service revenue, it goes up with a credit. It's increasing, so that will be a credit. The last example I have, which is a little bit different from the other ones, it's the equipment. Okay. Now, when we buy equipment and we start using it, I mean, it's like a car. When you buy a car, it's not going to hold the value forever. If you buy a car today for $20,000, it's going to start depreciating over time. It will depreciate. It will lose value. Depreciation means losing value. You buy today for $20,000. After a year, it's not going to worth $20,000 anymore. It will drop maybe, let's say, $4,000. So after a year, it's going to worth $16,000. And then every year it will drop. Same thing with equipment. In companies, we have to adjust the equipment account at the end of every month or every year. Depends on how much value it's decreasing. Okay, how much drop in the value. We call it depreciation. So when it comes to equipment, we're going to record a depreciation expense. That amount, the loss in value, we call it depreciation expense. Okay, so here's an example on that equipment that we purchased. It was $20,000. Here's a note about it. The equipment has a 5 years useful life and $4,000 residual value, which sometimes they call it salvage value as well. And then we're going to use the straight line method to calculate the depreciation expense. Okay, so it's $20,000 for 5 years, and residual value means at the end of the useful life, at the end of the life of that equipment, there will be still some value in it that we think that we can still sell it for that price, which is $4,000 in our example. So how much total depreciation are we going to record over the 5 years? So that will be $20,000 minus the residual value, which is $4,000, and that will equal $16,000. So the total depreciation over the 5 years will be $16,000. Okay. Now what we need to calculate here is how much is the depreciation per month during those 5 years. Okay. The 16 is for the entire 5 years. So $16,000, divide that by, so 5 years. Every year has 12 months, so multiply 5 by 12, that would be 60 months. So divide the 16,000 over 60 months to find out how much your depreciation expense per month is going to be. How much you're going to lose in value every month. So 16,000 divided by 60, it will be approximately $266.67. So I'm going to just round it to 267. You don't really need to round it. It depends on the company. Every company is different. So in our example, we just consider that it's okay to round. So $267 a month, that will be the depreciation for a month. So the equipment will lose value for 267. Now, the name of the expense account is depreciation expense. So I'm going to increase depreciation expense by 267,000, and then the credit. Now, someone might think it's logically to credit the equipment account. I totally agree with anyone who would think this way, because that's what we did with supplies. We credited supplies to decrease it. We did the same thing with prepaid rent. We credited prepaid rent to decrease it. So someone might think, well, we should also credit the equipment because it's also decreasing. Now, here's the thing. Yes, we're going to decrease the net equipment, but we're going to come up with a new account, and we're going to use that account for crediting instead of the equipment. And that's just for one reason, because if I credit equipment for $20,000, that means my ending balance will be less than $20,000. And then there's no way for us to come at a specific point and just look at the balance, the value for that equipment at a specific point of time and find out how much was the historical value. There's no way you can find out that it used to be $20,000. Now, because equipment, it's different from supplies and prepaid, it's more important, it's more expensive, it's more investors or owners of this company, they're going to be more curious about knowing how much it used to be initially and how much it's worth today. So we don't want to change the $20,000 just because we want to keep it showing up. We want to keep showing the historical value. So we will create a new account, which is going to be a contra asset account. We call it contra asset or contra equipment. Contra accounts normally have opposite balances. So for example, if every asset has a debit balance, a contra asset will have a credit balance, just like the account that I'm going to show you right now, which is accumulated depreciation. It's a contra asset, so it has a credit balance. Okay, it's opposite the normal balance of assets, and that will be $267 as well. Now, what happens with that account? Where do we see that account? So, equipment nothing is going to change to the $20,000. Okay, that's the historical value. But then in our statements, under the equipment, we will show the accumulated depreciation immediately after the equipment. It will show in the same statement, the same place, under the assets. For 267, and it has a credit balance, so credit in assets means negative. Okay, so that would be negative, and then in accounting, usually we put the amounts between parentheses if they have a negative balance. Okay, so 267 between parentheses, and then we subtract 20 minus 267, and that will be our net equipment. And that will be, after subtracting, that will be $19,733. Okay, so our net equipment is less than $20,000 because we depreciated some of the $20,000. Okay, and over time, every time you record the same journal entry at the end of every month for depreciating the equipment, every time you're gonna record. If we're using straight line method, we're going to use the same amount, okay? Because straight line method means we're going to, the amount of depreciation will be the same every month. That's what straight line means, straight, same amount every month. So you're going to record the same journal at the end of every month. That means your accumulated depreciation balance will keep increasing. It's accumulated, so it keeps accumulating. So 267, and then the following month, it will be 267 plus another 267, which would make it higher than that, which would make our net equipment less than the $19,733. So the more you depreciate, the higher that amount would be, the lower your net equipment would be. And that's true, because over time your net equipment has to decrease because you're depreciating it, because you're using it. All right. So those are the four different examples. There are more examples for adjusting entries, and those are just the most important ones that you need to know for deferral transactions. In our next video, we'll talk about the accrual, some examples on accrual transactions.